Okay, so good afternoon, everybody. Today I'm very happy to introduce Elli Pomoni, and she'll talk to us about dynamical spin chains in 4D n equals to 2 superconformative theories.
Thank you, Anna.
Thank you for accepting.
Thank you for having me. I mean, it's really a pity that I cannot be there because I have a lot of friends at Trinity, so it would be really great to go out for dinner and everything afterwards, but okay. And so please ask me questions because at least some of the parts of the talk will be quite technical. So yeah, please just interrupt and ask. And I have to say that this is some work. I mean, we wrote up already a paper some months ago with Kostas and Randall, but it's really like ongoing and things are really changing. And I have to say, I really don't know how to present it in a mild way to not, you know, harm your mind, but I will do my best. And yes, so the main point of the talk is about planar integrability. And I mean, we know that n equal to 4 super Young Mills is integrable by now. Everybody believes this. And now the question is, what can we do beyond that? Is n equal to 4 the only integrable theory? Of course, there is a little star here, and there is the beta deformed and some other, you know, sporadic theories. But what I would really like is I would like to have an organized way to remove supersymmetry and see what happens. And I mean, in this talk, I am not going to answer the integrability question, as you will see. But I will definitely, I think, settle the organized way. I'm very happy about that, actually. So let's talk about the past for a moment. So if you ask a random person from our field, like, are n equal to 2 theories integrable, they will tell you no. Because actually, some more than 10 years ago, we wrote this paper back in my PhD. And we checked for n equal to 2 theories if the usual Young-Baxter equation is not satisfied, and we found that it's not. And I want to come back to that. I want to say, well, this does not kill integrability, absolutely not. And I want to say how and what we should do about it. So let me start big, and let me start by reviewing that integrable models, at least the ones that we know up to now, they are classified mostly in 3 big classes. So there are the rational models, like XXX spin chain, which is governed, has an SU2 symmetry that flips the spin up and down. There are trigonometric models, where you naively lose the SU2, but actually it becomes quantum, so it's even better, or more cool somehow. And then there are elliptic models, which naively have no symmetry, but recent means after the 70s or 80s, people know very well that there actually are elliptic groups, and especially after the 90s and the work of Felder and a bunch of other mathematicians, like we really know a lot about these elliptic groups. And there are even models that are hyper-elliptic, so the spectral curve of these models have whatever genus, a lot, whatever you want. And there are examples of the chiral Potts model of such hyper-elliptic models. Let's, for the sake of this talk, forget about the hyper-elliptic, even though I am pretty sure that some gauge theories will go to this class, and let's concentrate to elliptic, just to, you know, have less things to say. And first of all, now I want to discuss why the Young-Baxter was not satisfied when we checked and why this does not kill integrability. And I want to make this statement, which is very well known by now, that depending on the basis that we use in order to write down our elliptic models, the models do not have to satisfy the standard Young-Baxter equation, but it is very well known after the work of Felder that they satisfy a dynamical Young-Baxter equation. I will use the terminology Baxter basis. I don't know if everybody likes this terminology, but I apologize. I will just use it. Baxter basis for the basis in which these models may obey the Young-Baxter equation. But this basis has one thing that is very important for me. It doesn't have a highest weight state. And well, we are studying superconformal field theories. And because of that, because of their beautiful supersymmetry, they have BPS operators. And these operators will correspond to highest weight states. So naturally, we are not in the Baxter basis. So clearly, there was really no reason why we should have expected in the past for the young Baxter to be satisfied. Now, on the top of what we know about elliptic models, there is even a bigger framework of quasi-Hopf algebras and symmetries. I am not going to kill you with any math. I will try to explain all the math in a visual way. Hopefully, it will work out. This is a much broader way of thinking, and it doesn't have to be integrable. But there is like a very big young Baxter equation that is satisfied when we have quasi-Hopf algebras. And then if you have this beautiful equation, or scary, depends on your point of view, you can go back to integrable models by making sure that this phi is the co-associator. So having this quasi-Hopf somehow associativity is somehow skewed with this co-associator object. And if this object obeys a specific condition, which is called shifted co-cycle condition, we go back to elliptic integrable models. Now let's talk about n equal to two theories. What I will say goes through for a big class of n equal to one theories also, but let's concentrate to n equal to two to see what is the magnitude of what I'm going to talk about. So first of all, n equal to two superconformal field theories have, for Lagrangians, for theories that have a Lagrangian description, are classified. And you can just open this paper and look at the list. And many, or actually most of them, they can be obtained via orbi folding n equal to four super young Mills, which is our integrable friend, and then marginally deforming it. And on the top of that, for all of these theories that can be obtained from orbi folds plus marginal deformations, we know the gravity duals, which is great because the AdS/CFT thinking will help a lot. And on the top of that, if we don't go through with this marginal deformation and we stick ourselves to the so-called orbi fold point, we know for many years now that these theories are integrable. Of course, this integrability back then, it's somehow a little bit pulled out of the hat. And I actually really believe that also what we are doing will actually help us understand even why this paper, like, because this is a magical paper. They just wrote down Beth Ansatz. Why? Okay, so whatever we are doing is helping for sure explain also what's going on here. And then, so all we need to do, in fact, on the top of that, is we need to understand what the marginal deformation does to our integrable, or to our model, not integrable yet. Great. So, of course, orbi folds of n equal to four, you have a lot of theories that you can say have huge families, infinite families. But let's look at the most baby one, because it's more than enough if we do that to understand everything that I want to talk about. So we will do a so-called Z2 orbifold, where the SUN color group of n equal to four super young Mills breaks into two n equal to two vector multiplets. And then we have hyper multiplets being bifundamental, having one index on the one color group and one index on the other. This is also depicted here where I show you the orbi folded matrices. So the X, Y, Z are the three holomorphic scalars of n equal to four. I choose my basis such that Z is in the diagonal and it's adjoint, and the other two guys are bifundamental. And I already said it, let me stress it. This theory is enough to discover everything, to discover the word dynamical and to discover the word elliptic. And also for the people that care, because everybody asks all the time, what about the Veneziano limit, the Veneziano? Well, if you just know this theory and you just take the one of the two coupling constants to go to zero, you recover superconformal QCD in the Veneziano limit. So that's all we need to understand. Great. So what is now practically the plan? So first of all, I will explain a little bit how to think about one-loop spin chains. And I will try to tell you why they are dynamical. First, in a totally baby and basically stupid way, but I think this way, this stupid way is very good for thinking. I mean, it took me a lot of time to start thinking in this way, so I will try to contaminate your thought immediately. And then I will try to tell you that this is n equal to two superconformal field theories. They in fact enjoy a much bigger theory symmetry than the one we thought they have. I will tell you that there is a quasi-Hopf symmetry algebra there. And the moment I understand that, I will immediately be able to write for you down an R matrix in the quantum plane limit and a twist from which it comes from. And this is, I mean, anyway, you will see, this will be really great. And then I will move on to something a little bit harder, a harder endeavor, but this is very good for organizing our thought. I will study the SU3 scalar sector. So I will have X, Y, Z. And I will try to show you that the n equal to two daughters, they basically can be mapped to a dynamical 15 vertex model. And finally, I mean, let's see if we have time. Usually there is no time, but we have explicit Bethe-Ansatz calculations, coordinate Bethe-Ansatz. And in fact, this is how I started thinking about this. If you study one magnon excitations around the center vacuum, you get this dispersion relation here for the one magnon. And well, this, because of the square root, is not a nice way to write the dispersion relation. Actually, you can write it using elliptic functions, and then you actually can immediately see the ellipticity, the elliptic properties of the model. And of course, the same thing happens when you go to two magnons, and you can play and check things and everything. So let's start. And again, the first part might feel a little bit annoying, but please bear with me. I will also introduce all of the notation I need for the rest of the talk. So first, and also for the people that they are not, you know, SCFT integrable, let me just introduce some words that I will use. I will say the XY sector. So I take the X and the Y scalars of n equal to four superlyamines, and I consider operators that are made only out of these two and no one else. And first of all, at the 11 of n equal to four, the spin chains that I can make out only the two of them, they look like this. At this stage, I have opened up the chain. So I have cut the operator in one point and just open up the chain. And these are the guys that I get. And for every state of n equal to four, after doing the orbifold, I get two daughters. I get one state, which if you look here in the detail, the only difference with the other one is that it starts, actually the first field, the first open color index is from the one color group and the other one is from the other. And this pitch chain is dynamical in precisely this sense. If I give you the first guy here, you know how to write down the state. And not only you know how to write the state, you will also know with how to act with the Hamiltonian or whatever other object you will want to act with later. So in this sense, this thing is dynamical. And okay, here I wrote these two states are Z2 conjugate, the one from to the other. And if you do a higher rank orbifold, you will have K of them, as many as the images of the orbifold. And this will be now my dynamical notation. So I will use the n equal to four notation. And then I will just specify here with an index one or two, which one is the first color group. And this will determine everything. Now, let's talk about the Hamiltonian a little bit. So in this sector, first of all, the Hamiltonians, when we do where we are in this business, they are always computed by computing one loop Feynman diagrams. So these pictures are pieces of the one loop Feynman diagrams that we need to compute. And this we computed back in the day of my PhD. And here in this lower part, I write down how you can have two sites, all the possible two sites that you can have, given the fact that the color indices are properly contracted. So naively, you would have twice as many, but these are not allowed by color contractions because, again, I'm in the large and limit, and every color index has to contract to the next one. And I also wrote the Hamiltonian in this way because you can beautifully see that the Hamiltonian really wants to split into half. And if you zoom in, I write here this one and here this one. Well, they are the same Hamiltonian. The only difference is that there is an overall kappa minus one here and an overall kappa. And other than that, they are the XXX Hamiltonians with a kappa or one over kappa. So in this sense, they are dynamical and they act now on this dynamical basis, which again is specified either with I is equal to one or two. Yes? And this kappa is the ratio between the two coupling constants. That's maybe the only thing that I would like you to remember for this talk, because there will be all these kappas everywhere. Yes. So going from one kappa to one over kappa, I just basically flip the two coupling constants. I use a Z2 symmetry of the orbifold. Great. Now let's do a little bit of a harder thing. This is the XZ sector. This sector is slightly more complicated because the Z fields are diagonal. And I am allowed to put as many as I want between the Qs. So basically, the Hamiltonian is not anymore simple, the spin chain is not anymore simply alternating, but is truly dynamical. I really need to have this dynamical thing in my mind in order to make progress. And again, you just look at the first guy here. If you know the first color index that is open, you can specify everything else. And in this sense, it's dynamical. And I will again use my n equal to four notation. And by the way, this symmetry here, the XZ, is precisely the symmetry that the orbifold breaks. So we don't expect to have an SU2 that acts and rotates these two guys. The same thing as before. We draw the Feynman diagram. Yes, question, yes.
So in the previous slide, mm-hmm. you were saying that if you know the first, you can kind of fix the rest, but there are many possibilities to put these phis, no? So in which sense you can...
If you give me the n equal to four state, which is what I write here always, and the first index, then there is nothing else.
Because you can fix completely all the possibilities, like all the, there is only one possibility at the end.
Yes, yes.
Okay, that's nice. Okay, thank you.
So that's why this dynamical notation is perfect. It precisely does that. Yes, and again, Feynman diagrams, we compute Feynman diagrams, we write down the Hamiltonian. Again, here, naively, you would write twice as many two sites, but they are not allowed by color contractions. So that's the basis. And then what we do, we write it in a dynamical form and we look closely and we see what we get. We have a temporally lib Hamiltonian, both here and here. The one just has the formation parameter kappa and the one over kappa. So we have a dynamical temporally lib type of spin chain to play with. And again, don't forget, kappa is the ratio of the two coupling constants. Okay, so we keep these things in mind, but for a little bit now, we will completely change the direction and we want to consider the Lagrangian of the theory. And we want to try to understand why the Lagrangian of the theory has a much bigger symmetry than what expected. I have to say that this is something that is known for the beta deformed to many people, for general marginal deformations to less people, but still this is a very well-known thing. And there is an infinity of papers one can study. And yes, I am sorry if I am insulting someone. I really don't want to do that, but I just would not fit to properly cite everyone. So in order to make progress, I will basically really copy what is known. So I will first prove the way it was done for the beta deformed that the n equal to 2 superconformal field theory has a quasi-Hopf symmetry algebra. I will discover it how? By looking at the F terms. And the F terms, they define for me a three-dimensional complex quantum plane from which I read off an R matrix in the quantum plane limit again. Okay, some mathematicians, they prefer Braid limits because of Braid groups, but for me, it's just the same. And then once I have the R matrix, I can plug it in this equation and I can get back always my quantum plane, so I know what I am doing. And also, the moment I know the R matrix, I can also check that the superpotential. Yes, there is a question.
I apologize, it's Anton here.
Hello.
Can you recap a few things regarding the previous slide? Because if I'm correct, from the original Giovanni's proposal on the dynamical chain, there is a reason that the only dynamical variable that you consider is your kappa, which is the ratio, because in the dynamical R matrix, like, at the level of your Hamiltonians, this is okay. This is a parameter.
But so wait, what I said up to now, it is only about the bases and the Hamiltonian. For the R matrix, we have to wait a little bit. So now I am preparing the stage for the R matrix.
Okay, because I need one more dynamical, which is a coordinate variable.
This is so you have to wait a little bit. You have to wait. Sorry. So now we are very baby. We have just a basis and just a Hamiltonian and nothing else.
Yeah, you mentioned the coordinate beta results, and this is why I got confused.
This will come, but we have to be a tiny little bit patient for this. Yes, because I need to introduce things in order to...
Okay.
Yes? So now I want to do something also baby, and again, you will not see a rapidity here, I'm sorry. I want to first calculate the R matrix in the quantum plane limit for you. And then we will find a way to, or we will try to find a way to decorate it. Yes? But what is important is the moment we know this, we can check invariance of the superpotential under the quantum group. And this is amazing. This is a very new result. So nobody knew that n equal to 2 theories have actually a much bigger symmetry than SU 2, 2 slash 2. So let's go for this first. Okay, first I do something. I'm sorry for the experts, but I don't know. I think it makes sense to start baby. So this is the simplest example of a quantum plane. So naively, there is no Q here, and we have x, y is y, x, and everything is commuting, and we are very happy. But when they are not, we just have a Q. It captures the non-commutativity. And mathematicians like to write actually the R matrix in this form. We plug it in this equation with lambda is equal to square root of Q, and we get back our beloved quantum plane. And not only that, the moment we know this R matrix, we can do more. First of all, we can write down the transformations of this quantum plane. So if we label the transformations in this way, we can in fact plug in the RTT relations, the R matrix. Here I did this exercise for you, and we discover the UQSL2 algebra. Moving to one step harder, we need to consider three-dimensional quantum planes. And thankfully for us, these are classified by mathematicians. And they told us that we need to know two tensors and then we win. So there is a tensor E and a tensor F for the quantum plane and the quantum coplane. For us, co will just be dagger. So we will just have complex number and we just dagger things and we get F, great. And the moment we know these matrices, we just plug in this equation. There is some normalization that is allowed that one needs to think a little bit about. And then we can write down the R matrix. And again, as I said before, the moment you know this, you can plug it in this lambda relation and you get back these equations. And you also plug in RTT and you can write down the quantum algebra. So this is very easy. So this was done very early on for the Lee-Strassler theory for marginal deformations of n equal to 4. I don't want to insist on that too much. I just want to say that either you look at the quantum plane and you read off what the R matrix is, or, and that's actually, I like it a little bit better, you look at the n equal to 4 superpotential and you ask, how do I need to dress it in order for me to write the Lie-Strassler Lagrangian? So, you know, the Levi-Civita becomes some E, and this is the one I need to know in order to write down my Hamiltonian, my R matrix, and everything. And then also to discover what is this quantum version of SU3. Now, before I do it for us, I want to give an ADS way of thinking. So in the gravity dual, we know that for the Lie-Strassler, but also very similarly, it will be for our orbifold case, we need to turn on a B field. And we do that in the transverse to the D3 directions, to the C3 that is transverse. So when we do that, when we have a B field, the open strings, what they see, that the open strings that end on the D3 branch, they see actually a non-commutative geometry. This is like a very old result before I even started my PhD. So basically what these guys told us is that open strings see a quantum plane. So the quantum plane that I'm talking about, that I like to discover from the F terms, in fact, comes from Cyber-Witten. And Manuela worked out the gravity side for the Lie-Strassler back in the PhD days, back at Stony Brook. So whatever Manuela did back then, we can actually identically do if we want for the orbifolds. And here I have for you the dictionary between the two couplings of just this simple Z2 orbifold theory with, of course, the string coupling, but also the B field. Yes? And here is now...
Sorry, Elli. Oh, yes. Can I ask a question? Sorry, about this ADS construction. So it does this give you the supergravity background? I thought it didn't. We didn't know the Lie-Strassler background in general for the H deformation, right?
I have to say this. You should ask Manuela because I don't know very well. But
so let me ask you. In your case, do you know the geometry corresponding to these n equals two theories?
Yes.
And you can prove that they're classically integrable.
I have not studied the. I mean, maybe you can help me.
Okay.
I have not studied the string yet.
But you know the full supergravity background.
I know the supergravity background, and in principle, of course, there is a little bit pain involved, and this is why I haven't done it yet. I can write down string stuff. Yes. Everything is known.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yep. Thanks.
So here is the analysis, like the ones that the beta deformed and the whatever Lie-Strassler people did back in the day, the equivalent of that for our case. So here, first of all, I write it for you in two different ways, just because I can and why not. So these are the F-term the F-terms. And you see, first of all, that they come in three classes. This is the XY, the YZ, and the YZ and the XZ. And they come in two images because we have a Z2 orbifold. So we have two images of the C3 plane. And also you see here that I can also do this exercise. I can think that I have the N equal to four Lagrangian and plug in twice some epsilon tensors. And this gives me the n equal to two Lagrangian or superpotential. And these epsilons, these E's, sorry, are precisely the ones that I can plug in the formula that I showed you before from the mathematicians and get the R matrix. So I know the R matrix and I compute it. For the XY vector, this R matrix is just proportional to the identity. And for the other two sectors, I write here the answer for you. And let's make some comments. So first of all, for the XZ sector, the fact that the R matrix is one is like we expect, I mean, we should have better gotten that because there is an SU2. So the SU2 is not broken. It's really, and that's why also when I was showing you the Hamiltonian, I wrote that this is an alternating XXX spin chain. So we really have an SU2. On the other hand, on the other two sectors, the SU2 that naively rotates the two scalars is broken. And that's why we got a more crazy looking R matrix. And maybe one thing that maybe is interesting is that the upper part and the lower part, again, if you send kappa to 1/kappa, or you exchange the two gauge couplings, you get the from the one to the other block. So again, it really wants to be dynamical. And also having that, what I can do, first of all, I can plug it in the RTT relations and I can write what is the, I call it SU2 kappa, whatever, some quantum group that is labeled by kappa. And it's super easy to write down the algebra. And another thing you can do is that you can observe that you can write it as a square of a Drinfeld twist. And the moment, and here I write explicitly for you what the Drinfeld twist is, and the moment I know the Drinfeld twist, I win. Because I go to Drinfeld's, I have all the math discovered by Drinfeld for me. So I really have a quasi-Hopf symmetry algebra going on. And one last thing, because this is very important. Well, the superpotential basically has this symmetry. So we can check, and we can do this. In order to do this for the superpotential, you should consider how this SU2 kappa symmetry is embedded in SU3. So you need to consider all three scalars, right? And you can check explicitly that these symmetry transformations, once you write them down, of course, explicitly, together with a coproduct that, of course, has to be compatible with the twist I just talked about, leaves invariant the Lagrangian. Yes, this is an important statement. And so at this stage, we have checked, but this is in fact the hardest calculation. We have checked super explicitly that our Lagrangian has an SU3 kappa symmetry. And we are currently working on checking that in fact, the full supergroup is there, kappa deformed, as basically this SU3, because that's the only thing that you really need to do carefully, and then you just embed this in here carefully. And another thing, of course, we want to do integrability and we want to check everything, but one thing that is really cool is that we can check that the BPS spectrum organizes, in fact, in multiplets of this SU3 kappa symmetry. So the R symmetry generators that naively you would think are broken, you can use them and act and really build the multiplet state by state. And we've done that. And hopefully it will come out very soon, mod Christmas and other problems that we have in lives. Great. So let me make a bold conjecture. The bold conjecture goes like this. Any theory with lower than n equal to 4 supersymmetry, and let's maybe stick to supersymmetric theories so that nobody will complain very badly, that can be obtained by Orbi folding or Orienti folding also would go, or dot, dot, dot. And here, dot, 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 I mean any method of breaking supersymmetry that is due to R symmetry breaking, will enjoy, whether you like it or not, just use what I have done, a quantum deformation of the PSU2,2/4. And the broken, the naively broken generators, when we go from the PSU2,2/4 to the SU2,2/whatever supersymmetry, they will get upgraded to quantum generators. Are there any questions or complaints up to now? Because this is the one big bold thing.
So maybe I can ask a question. So this bit here has nothing to do with planarity, right?
This has nothing. It has to do with one thing, basically. You have to be careful when you do double trace. So every Lagrangian, every poor Lagrangian, mm-hmm. even the n equal to 4 one, has a double trace baby in there.
Mm-hmm.
So I have to say, because I really want to go planar, I haven't checked carefully what happens. But I expect that this will maybe break for the double trace guy.
But actually, okay, fair enough. But let me ask, I mean, just, so here actually the symmetry is that of the superpotential, right?
So the superpotential and the Kähler part, actually trivially,
you can take. So if you take like the Lee-Strassler deformation, the double trace terms kind of, you don't have double trace terms there, right? There, I think when you write it in terms of n equals one superfields, you only have single trace, and the double trace appear when you integrate out the auxiliary fields.
Correct, yes.
So here, at least for Lee-Strassler, you wouldn't have any double trace issues, and these symmetries would be of the full Lagrangian.
So when naively we write everything in n equal to one superfield formalism, we don't see any reason why this should be not for, it looks like it doesn't have to be for planar.
Yeah, no, and then of course, yeah, and of course then you can sort of guess, like, then is it connected to integrability or is it something different?
This is a very important question and I don't have something smart to say.
Yeah, yeah.
But I thought Kostas thought it's not that it's indeed there, no? Didn't he show that this quantum deformations are there for all the Lee-Strassler, but that for example, because of non-associativity, the H deformation or whatever is not integrable as well, or perhaps somehow the two are interconnected. So the presence of the quantum deformation does not guarantee integrability as far as I remember.
So this is correct, but I think Tristan is asking a more basic question. He's asking, forget about integrability, who cares? Is this symmetry there, not only at the planar limit, but also at finite n? Right, Tristan, am I right?
That's true. But then what Manuela says is, would be sort of my follow-up question, that like, if it is there, then would we, and we know integrability is not. So yeah, I guess I'm asking, yeah, what is the relation? But as you say, it's still.
Honestly, the fact that Pedro Vieira can use his magic to compute, it is something that integrability wants to talk also to non-planar stuff, right?
That's right.
But it's in a way that we have no way to understand.
Exactly. Like the spectrum, the non-planar spectrum is not integrable. This is like not in the same way. There's no, you know, infinite symmetry.
I have to say that one of the things that is annoying in the usual way we do integrability, and here we were very careful when we did the BPS, we actually constructed the multiplets operator by operator.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And this exercise was actually super educational. So we really took the broken generator, we acted on XXX, you know, and we really got all the other ones one by one.
Mm-hmm. No, actually, I don't know, but yeah, it seems very plausible that this quantum deformed symmetry is there for the BPS operators, completely, but not just in any sort of limit. Yeah, yeah. But yeah, okay, thanks. No, that's very interesting.
Okay, if we are happy with what is going on, we can move on. This part of the talk will become a little bit more technical. So I'm sorry.
In kind of first approximation for understanding, at least for me, the integrable system which described n equal 4 anomalous dimension can be viewed as supergroup Baxter equation. Okay, that's what, with long discussion with Wallin and so on, I understood that I can think that way. So there is a supergroup SU, whatever, 2,2/4. It has a Baxter equation for that spin group. And then analytic properties I have to put to make sure that I get the right anomalous dimension. Now, you took the orbifold, you went to, you broke n equals 2. But still there is kind of hiddenly somewhere this n equal 4 theory. What happens with that supergroup spin chain, the Baxter equation that I...
Yes, I have absolutely not written the Baxter. So actually now we are at the stage that I'm just trying to write down the supergroup. And then the point would be what is the whatever Jungian or elliptic version of Jungian of that. But that's
before we get to elliptic, I just want you to understand that because I actually anticipate that moment you get to elliptic, at least as it's known from Baxter and Taftajan and Fadev and so on, there will be this problem that you will not, but the beta equation does not respect elliptic function, so you have to have the theta vacuum, and it's not kind of, it's not a good system for XYZ, as you know very well. The just beta equation, left hand side and right hand side transform, you have to put this twist and theta and all these kind of things. It's about, so that, those things will be problem. But I thought that in n equal 4 integrability, on top of the Baxter equation, which was super spin chain Baxter equation, the analytic properties that you had to complement with already were very similar, like in XYZ model, because they were not a traditional analytic properties, right? So ellipticity, of course, will make it complicated, but it's already there in n equal 4 super spin chain, lowest weight, highest weight, and so on. So somehow that n equal 4 analytic properties of super spin chain Baxter equation was halfway to XYZ model.
Yes.
So now you are upgrading that. So I want to understand what remains and what disappears.
Yes. By the way, what you say is very important. And I have to say that part of my motivation to do what I'm doing, I actually think that I will understand n equal to 4 better. Because n equal to 4 to all loops has the same dispersion relation as my model. I mean, the people that have worked forever on this, I'm sorry that I'm doing this skipping, it's basically the same equation. It's just that this guy is not there. It's the same. But the only crazy difference is that this guy is one loop. I got this scary square root already at one loop. So what I hope is, because I can already do all this madness at one loop, which is nearest neighbor, I actually hope that I will understand n equal to 4 better.
Because well, I'm sorry, I'm engaging on discussion because certain elements I've been interested ages ago. So you have said several times already that the dynamical R matrix is becoming important once you go to n equal 2, right?
Yes, so at this stage, you will see where I am. I don't quite have the R matrix yet. The full R matrix. Let's go there.
I want you to comment on that. So yes. The Felder, Giovanni, 20 whatever, 30 years ago, confused the people about this term, with this terminology of dynamical R matrix and dynamical whatever spin chain, because way, let's say, people in Leningrad thought about this was before, was like this. So there is an R matrix, and then there is a 6J symbol. There are two things related, and they are not the same. So what Felder later incarnated as a dynamical R matrix actually is a 6J symbol.
I agree with you. Yes.
You see what I'm saying? The difference is like air source and the spin chain relation. So what happens at the, forget about that it is dynamical. It's actually a regular stuff. Yes. It is just the 6J symbol and not the R matrix. And then everything becomes clear. Now, in the discussion with Volin, and my knowledge of this is completely based what I was talking with Dimitra long ago when he worked with us, was that 6J symbols don't show up in n equal 4 theory.
Yes.
Now you got n equal 2 theory, suddenly you got 6J symbols.
Now they will have to show up whether you like it or not.
Right. So
and maybe we will have to learn how to calculate them. Yes.
So maybe that was a trick. That's the actually proper way to think about n equal 4 theory.
Is to do n equal 2.
Not in terms of R matrices. And then maybe eventually it will end up that n equal 4, the beta equation and so on, actually will have Young's function. Because what he wrote, the coordinate beta ansatz, right? I 100% guaranteed that has a Young's function. Your dispersion relations comes from certain one function with minimization, which is not the case for n equal 4. So I actually think that what you're talking maybe proves that there was something not well understood in n equal 4 case.
I agree.
Okay, thanks.
Yeah, I completely agree. Basically, thank you very much for saying this, because honestly, this is like, yeah, we really have to do what I'm doing, basically. Okay, let's go. So now it will be baby. I'm sorry for this, but I didn't know who knows what. So I have to always have some baby stuff. So I want to talk about vertex models now. Yes, so super quick review, the XXZ spin chain, the algebraic Bethans that can be understood as a 6-vertex model, XYZ elliptic 8-vertex model, and maybe a comment here, which is related with, so the way Baxter solved the 8-vertex model, and also Takhtazan and Fatev, is, well, what they did a local change of basis that made the R matrix of the 8-vertex model look like a 6-vertex model locally, and that's how they solved. Because otherwise, I don't know. Good luck. Now, in terms of for elliptic algebras, because here there is another big confusion, so I need to make this this statement. There are two types of elliptic algebras. So there is the vertex type and the face type. These are just names if you don't know more. But what is important is that these guys, an example of an R matrix is the Baxter-Belavin one, and it obeys the YBE. And when you go to face type, you have R matrices or weights of Andrews Baxter-Forrester. I will review this right now. And Felder showed that this R matrix obeys the dynamical Young-Baxter equation. And yes, it is, anyway.
Terminological. Felder called it dynamical Young-Baxter equation, but before it was called 6J symbol.
Yes, I agree. Yes, absolutely. Yes.
I just want to make, so this dynamical blah, 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 blah is not something new. It is just
a 6J symbol. I agree, but you will have to forgive me for the rest of the talk because I am using now Felder's.
No, that's okay. Well, it was explained that it is just the R matrix which depends on spectral parameter, and there is a monochromy matrix that doesn't commute with it, and putting together, it's a definition of 6J symbol.
Yes. So, and another important thing between this and this stuff. It's not another model or whatever. It is just that the two algebras are related by a twist. And this is in this paper and of course other papers. And again, also for us, because we have BPS operators and we have highest weight states, we need to have a phase type algebra. So I am looking for a phase type elliptic algebra to describe what I need and then the rest of it. Good. So having said words, let's describe the Andrew Baxter-Forrester model. People call these things SOS models, solid on solid. They are statistical mechanics models that live in a square lattice. And they are basically defined by just Boltzmann weights that are associated to each phase. And each Boltzmann weight has a rapidity in it, U. And then at each corner, there is an integer. They are called the heights, and basically specifying which type of heights you are allowed to have precisely defines the model for you. So the Andrews Baxter-Forrester model can have heights at neighboring corners only if they differ by one. So you cannot have here one. Okay, you can have 1, 0, 1, 0, for example. And saying that, of course, it is an art to write down the weights. I am not gonna comment further on that because I have to say this is one of the things that I'm actually currently learning, maybe not for this model, maybe for harder models, but how I give you the rules and you write these guys down is an art, I think. And then the moment you know the W's, integrability is checked by plugging in everything in the star triangle relation and checking that it indeed holds. So this is a serious now criterion of integrability. And these models are elliptic. And this is the framework I need. So now, yes, what Felder did, the way I think of it very basically, is that he basically just took Andrews Baxter-Forrester and he made it into an R matrix by doing this transformation. by doing the so-called vertex face map. So he took this and he wrote it like this. And here is, you can see the elliptic functions that go into his R matrix. And here I have the dynamical Young-Baxter that he derived. And yes, what is important, I have already shown you that my model has quasi-Hopf. In order to show that I can go from this to this, I need to show this shifted cocycle condition. Let's say a few more words about Felder in a very graphical way. So now we become more modern. And so there was this very beautiful paper by Yagi, who actually for me was really great because I couldn't understand otherwise very nicely. He explained how we can just draw and understand everything. And this is also very good for understanding why at the level of the R matrix, our models are dynamical. So what Felder tells you is that you have an R matrix, which on the top of everything else has a dynamical parameter lambda, which every time you cross an index line, it gets shifted by something that is proportional to the representation, yes, in which the I is. So here is how we draw it. So we draw the R matrix and the indices, and on the left of it, right here, we specify the dynamical parameter. So now let's look at this picture. For example, this green R matrix, if I decide that here I represent the dynamical parameter with lambda, and here I write this R matrix like this, I cross and I go here, for example, and I want to write this R matrix down. Here I see that this guy is lambda prime because I crossed this line. Lambda prime is this because this is line number two. So what I write here is precisely this lambda prime. And that's how graphically I can understand everything. And again, remember that all I need, I want to specify my color group here. And then every time I cross, I always know what to do. So this is really like what I need. But there is a problem. So Felder is not good enough for us. And the point is that Felder, no matter what we do to him, he always shifts the dynamical parameter when we cross a line, and that's not good for the theories we are studying. Why this is the case? Why Felder is not good enough? He's not good enough because we have the adjoint fields, phi one and phi two, which live in a Z, in a bigger Z field of n equal to four. And these just don't shift lambda, because after them, if you ask the next field, what is your color group, they will say the same answer. So Felder doesn't allow for that. So in order to accommodate for these guys, we need to enhance the type of models we are looking for. And we need to look for models that are called either, first of all, dilute is the important word here, and either a restricted source or cyclical source. Actually, what we have is this one. We have a cyclic if we do a ZK orbital, for example. And maybe because of time, I will not tell you everything that I know, but what is very important is that I can have extra type of plaquettes, extra type of weights for these models that before were not allowed. Yes? And these models, they were studied by many people. Yeah, anyway, this was a beautiful field of statistical mechanics. Now let's construct our model in the remaining, whatever, something like 5 minutes. So we are looking for the R matrix, who of course gives the Hamiltonian when we take the derivative, but also has the following properties. Its dynamical parameter is somehow a function of lambda, of kappa, the ratio of the two coupling constants. Or of course you can say that lambda is a function of kappa, however you like it. The important thing is the periodicity properties that it has. So when we cross it by a fundamental field, we basically flip the color indices. So kappa goes to 1/kappa. So in the dynamical language, lambda then has to go to plus or minus to eta. Yes, that's the first thing. Second thing, this translates to an equation, they are matrix, has to obey, they are matrix. So for this definition of kappa going to lambda, 1 over kappa will go to lambda plus 2 eta. Now let's cross twice, because we have a z2-orb fold. When we cross twice, we come back to ourselves, 2 by fundamentals. So kappa goes to 1 over kappa and then to kappa again. And then we see that this is the periodicity of our model. Our periodicity is 4 eta. So this is what the R matrix needs to satisfy. And on the top of that, as I stressed in the previous slide, when we cross a Z, nothing happens. It doesn't alter the gauge group. So lambda should not be shifted. And this is precisely the notion of the dilute. So first of all, for simple moves, this is the model. This captures all the moves that are allowed. So when I cross an X, I go from lambda to lambda plus 2 eta. When I cross a Y, I go to minus that. And let's find a Z. Here is a Z. When I cross a Z, nothing happens. So this is written knowing just that. And of course, the amount of vertices that I wrote here obey the n equal to 2 R symmetries. So SU2 times U1. So just with this information, you write down this, like what the model is. And there is one thing that is needed to finalize the job, and that's the following. So this 15 vertex model that I just wrote, just because of what I said, is basically the 15 vertex model of any SU3 sector of any n equal to 2 superconformal field theory. To specify precisely which one it is, we need the so-called adjacency graph. We need to give the topology of the quiver. We need to feed in somehow the topology of the quiver. Because for the Z2 quiver, when we shift, when we go back after two by fundamentals, we go back to the same dynamical parameter. But for other quivers, we need to do more shifts. And this is precisely captured by these pictures. And here, okay, I draw only three examples just to not destroy your brain. You can see precisely. Every time I move with a Z, nothing happens. In the Z2, from one to the other, I go back. Z3, I need to do this one more time. And this completely fixes what is the model we are talking about. And this type of pictures appear in, of course, in this paper and in like many, many, many papers that were written after that. So let me make two conjectures. One is, I think, super solid. This is a little bit less, but if I specify something, then you will like it. So first of all, every n equal to 2 theory has a holomorphic SU3 sector, which can be captured by a dynamical 15 vertex model, as long as I specify this adjacency graph that I just drew before. And this, experimentally, because I just did it for many theories, is precisely due to the brain tiling of Hanani. So this is good. And I can do the same thing for n equal to 1 theories. N equal to 1 theories, because of their R symmetry, in fact, generically allow for more possible vertices. So generically allow for 19 vertex models. And their adjacency graph is also always the brain tiling, the dual to the brain tiling. So this is the conjecture. Yes? What can I do with time now? Because now it's becoming a little bit too much. Anna, maybe you are the boss.
Yeah, I don't know. It has been 1 hour, but there were lots of questions. So if you'd like to...
I have another chapter, if you wish, in the talk. And the other chapter is the Bethe-Ansatz. But maybe what I can do is that I can conclude, and then the people that really care, they can stay and we can do Bethe-Ansatz. We can do whatever we want.
Yeah, that sounds great. Yeah.
Okay. I mean, some of the conclusions I already said. So the first new result is the fact that there is an SU3 quantum symmetry. This is a very serious thing. A second very serious thing is that the SU3 scalar sectors of basically n equal to 2 is mapped to a dynamical 15 vertex model. And by giving the adjacency or the brain tiling, I fix the model. Beth Ansatz, we can talk about it. Okay, this is a review of the conjectures. And there are many nice things to do now. Yeah, maybe I flash a little bit. I mean, the gravity duals, it's time that we start doing things here. Yeah, I just leave it. And yeah, thank you.
Okay, so let's thank Elli for the very nice talk. I never know how to do online. And
actually, maybe... I have one more comment and I have to go after that. I'm very sorry.
Yes, please, please.
There is a nice way, actually, there is a way of thinking about this dynamical situation similar to RTT equals TTR. So there are several ways of formulating quantum groups, as you know, and so on, but there is a one which comes from Leningrad, which is based on the transfer matrix and R matrix. And in that approach, actually, it starts, if you remember, with something called L, and LL equals LL times R. So R is on one side, not on both sides.
Yes.
So in that approach, that L is supposed to be periodic. Yes. But if you put the condition that when you go around in the spectral parameter, when you go around, there is a monodromy matrix. So L is not periodic. And call it M. You have a system of two objects now. One is L and another is monodromy matrix. And generically, it can be diagonalized. Basically, you have kind of RTT situation when there is a monodromy matrix. Together, this system is equivalent to what's called dynamical situation. So this monodromy matrix case plays a key role. So in quantum version, when it becomes like 6J symbol, mm-hmm. That is the one that measures the spin, because this monodromy matrix is like diagonal matrix and it has some entries. It's something like characterized by Weil group. And when you have the ZK orbifold Kuiper diagram or something like that, that's where they live. Okay, so moment you have this quiver structure, right, you get analog of what they would call in Leningrad the monodromy matrix in addition to L operator. And that, I think, is what you are getting generic station. So the way Giovanni had it, as I said, it's different. So if you think... going from regular situation to your situation, you have an additional matrix, which I would call monodromy matrix. This is what you call shifts, right? You are acting and it shifts.
Absolutely, acting, yes.
Right? So that is, let's call it a new operator. Okay, let's call it M. Okay, so now you take your old operator, which has LL equals LL times R, and then you have this M, which has very concrete relation with L. I mean, M times L is equal, and there is a formula for it. This is what comes from what used to be called restricted SOS model, the RSOS model. And then we used to say that all RSOS is equivalent. There is a kind of duality between RSOS model and a spin model. And so this has to be the same, but it was not always the same. So I think that what you have is that. So you have a new operator, which you can just postulate. Just because you have this Zn orbifold, you have a new operator, and now play the game with RTT with extra thing, right? It will simplify stuff, because what will happen at the end, that you will end up probably as you already ended up with RSOS model or CSOS model, you would have it from the beginning. That's just my comment that it can be formulated from the beginning in terms of monodromy matrix and L operator in the same way as normally. And that's what you have, I think.
I think you, can you recommend one Leningrad paper to read?
I don't know. I mean, no. I know what I know. So this, what I just said, a piece of it is written in some of my paper with Anton Alexeev, but it's about Vesmina-Witten model, but it's the same thought. In Vesmina-Witten model, you have constant R matrix, but there is also a dynamical version of constant R matrix. And so because it's conformal field theory and so on. But in the paper with Alexeyev, it's called quantum groups and Wesel-Meyer-Witten model. There is something about it. But what I just said, I don't know where it is written, but I mean, talking to people and friends and so on. Another comment, and then I have to really go, is that you have this Betanzas part that you had no time to talk.
Yes, I'm sorry.
That quick question. Do you have a beta equation which has the Young's function, or that one does not have a Young's function?
No, I only have very baby stuff for the, yeah, no, it becomes very quickly very hard. I can also tell you what my problem is there. Oops, not here. My main problem is that I am not sure yet how to pick the rapidity correctly. It's a very stupid problem. So I am doing things like this. And I can do this for the one magnon problem. I can do it for the two magnon problem. I can also observe something insane that one magnon, two magnon, I can see that every time I act with a Z2 orbifold or the whatever ZK operator, I get this type of eigenvalues.
Sorry, this is for 15 vertex. This is for 15 vertex model, or it has something.
This is for a smaller sector that is inside the 15 vertex. That has only two, X and Z, for example.
Okay, so if I do tau goes to minus one over tau, do I have a problem of beta equation like usually?
This is the problem. It's not so simple, because for me it's great what you get if you do tau to one over tau. It is more or less a symmetry of my problem. It is related with the Z2 quiver.
It has to be a symmetry, but as you remember, in the case of eight vertex model, when you have basically same beta equation, as instead of rational function, you have theta function divided by theta function. Okay, so you have theta divided by theta, but now theta depends on tau, these characteristics, and you do tau goes to minus one over tau, you realize that if you had one on the right-hand side, it will change. So what you have to do there, when you do tau goes to minus one over tau, you have to put Q on the right-hand side, which is exponential of I theta, and you have to shift theta. That's what they call theta vacuums there. You have to shift theta by sum of all rapidities, and then it's again invariant.
It's very similar to what happens here.
Okay, so that is the reason why in eight vertex model, Baxter had to pick a theta vacuum or Taftajan-Fadev. It's very well explained in Taftajan-Fadev.
Yeah, Taftajan-Fadev, I also understand, yes.
Okay,
yes.
In 1939 paper. And the funny thing is, this phenomenon actually is related, what I just described, is related to anomalies in N equal to super Young Mills in four dimension when you couple to background fields. So if you think about N equal two theory, not just one theory, but a set of theories coupled to background gauge fields, the abelian gauge fields, what I just said is a fact that when you couple to abelian gauge fields, that guy is anomalous. It has a Toft anomaly. And in both cases, so this relation is well known. But now, what you will be describing here, if it does not have that problem, I'm confused. So what you have to get, that your theta function divided by theta function, blah, 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 should have slight anomaly when tau goes to minus one over tau. No anomaly for tau goes to tau plus one. And as you know, in XYZ model, it's a symmetry of a spin check. These are modular transformations which act on the inhomogeneities, and it's a symmetry of Hamiltonian. But beta equation does not have that symmetry.
Exactly. It transforms precisely with this eigenvalue.
Yes.
So you can call it an anomaly. Right, yeah. Yes. Yeah. You can absolutely call it an anomaly in this sense.
Eli, I think that is a hint that you have a right equation.
Yes.
Because if you suddenly would tell me you don't have this anomaly problem, I would say something is fishy. Okay, thanks. That were two comments, no questions.
Thank you. This is amazing. It's good that we recorded because I can watch it afterwards.
Okay, thank you so much. It was very great. I have to go. I am actually.
Thank you very much for all the comments. Thank you very, very much.
Bye-bye.
Any more questions?
Yeah, Elli, there are a number of questions, but actually one of these Can you, I think I addressed you this question before, but maybe now you have a moment. Is there a reason, like if you remember in the, in between what Felder was doing was this mapping between, like you say, vertex face.
Yeah, okay, yes, let's go there.
Mm-hmm.
Here. No, this is the.
Okay. So my point is the following. So essentially, can you maybe point number one is that can you say why is it important that you want really to have a highest weight state and for me not to go with the say Bakhtar Belavin R matrix?
Yes. Exam.
Suppose I give you what is called, I have a better answer for the Baxter-Belavin, which has no reference states like you would desire for the elliptic case, but you are able to compute it.
So let me go, first of all, actually, let me even go back to this type of slide here.
Mm-hmm.
So what I have been doing, and this is really amazing, I can really, you know, make a multiplet by starting with, let's say, XXX, and acting with the broken generators and write down the full, so every eigen state precisely what it is, right?
Yes.
And because of this multiplet, let's take the SU2 quantum in here. The sigma plus and the sigma minus will kill the one state, the XXX one, and the sigma minus will kill the ZZZ one, right? So these guys, when I write in this beautiful language, they are highest weight. Now, what you want me to do in order to go to a Belavin-Baxter basis, I can do this. I can absolutely do it. I'm just afraid. I can do it by doing, go to this paper.
Yeah.
In this paper, they tell me how to go from here with a twist. In fact, by the way, they were not the first to do it, but anyway. This is the nicest to read paper. And I know the twist. It's just that when I actually write it down and I look at it, it's super scary. That's the only thing I can say. Honest thing I can say.
Maybe I don't want to speculate too much, but why I'm maybe insisting on this, you see, like you say, there is not clear, when you arrive at the beta ansatz for a particular subsector.
Mm-hmm.
But there is, doesn't matter. There is one scene which I'm starting now is the following, that if you have this well-defined, if you have a consistent prescription, you have this Belavin R matrix, there is algebraic beta ansatz for which it works. This is called, but somehow it combines both. It combines what Samson was saying with a RTT plus some constraints which are coming from the quantum inverse scattering. So in a sense, this is a combination of Fadiev-Tehtarjan 78 and a certain generalization on the RTT algebra.
Let me try to ask a question because I have done some calculations like this.
Okay.
So, because first of all, one statement is that there is also the Felder-Varchenko Bethe ansatz. Uh-huh. So I could just use that, right?
Yes.
Now, yes. Do you somehow claim that this monodromy matrix in some way? So basically, what you want to tell me is that this Tahtazan-Fadev paper, they have this non-local transformation, right? That they do at every site. And you want to tell me that basically this transformation is precisely that, and this brings me to this basis. That's what you are trying to tell me.
Part of it. I'm saying that,
I'm trying to combine it also with what, yes.
Yes. What I'm saying, I think that this is what has happened, but this is not just quantum inverse scattering for the Heisenberg XYZ. This is not just Fadiev-Tehtarjan. That's what I'm trying to say.
I mean, I guess it's harder.
This something else has to do with what I'm saying, was this combined RTT relations. This is, there is also a paper on this.
Which paper?
Zotov, Zabrodin, Slavnov. Yeah, but okay. I see your point. Yeah, but I'm just wondering why I'm interested in this, because if you go, there is something similar which is happening in the what is called elliptic deformations of the ADS integrable sectors, like ADS2. That's what we have been discussing with Marius before. And I was looking at this. There is something happening exactly. You don't have a reference state, and so there is an actual prescription of this Bilal-Lunar matrix. But then there is a question of this Betanzas. The punchline is the following. I'm just wondering if you proceed with this, you would still have this this Q transformation problem, like what you have now in the other setups. So, namely, the second question is if other better ansatz are helping.
But okay. I don't know. The coordinate better ansatz that I have been doing,
yes,
it's scary. And this thing that he called the anomaly, and I like it. Why not? It's a good name. I have been trying to tell to Kostas forever that this is a feature. It's not bad. It's great.
Mm-hmm.
You see, I was trying to study modular forms to find the one that,
yeah,
to,
you, yeah, know. Yeah.
I mean, it has to be in a modular form book. I don't have it yet, but I have things that look very close. And honestly, I can actually make a crazy conjecture. So every time you act with a Z2, even the whatever million body problem, it will spit out this thing whatever million times, however many magnons there are. This is what this does. Okay, so you, the n,
yeah, body, yeah,
the n magnon problem is the eigenvector of the z whatever k orbifold, sure, with this eigenvalue to the whatever body power. That's my conjecture, and I actually really think it's correct. And I just need to find a mathematical framework for that. And I think I am very close, but I cannot show the page of the book and I say this is my, yeah.
So you say this local effect of the, say, n-fold action of the Z2 would exactly contribute only through these ones.
Yes, this is the eigen. So when I act on the, so I have it very explicitly for one body and for, so one magnon, two magnon.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
When I act with a Z2, I get this stuff for the one magnon and this stuff squared for the two magnons.
Okay. Yeah, yeah. It would be good, of course, to have, if you, like I'm saying, if there is a, like a recursive n-fold expression for this, like you say, to the raising towards the power. Yeah, that's natural. But then you would need to consider, yeah, higher magnet systems. Okay, maybe I can do Anna, very, maybe last, if I'm allowed, one point. So Elli, if you see, if you have this n equals 4, and if you, this argument, like you say, this is indeed, this is high argument. If you go below, I'm starting doing breaking. I go below the four supercharges. Like you say, the co-product you write looks, I mean, very conventional. There is nothing special going. What I'm wondering, this is probably okay. If you can comment on this, this probably maybe you are doing now since you mentioned you work on the supergroup. I'm just wondering have you noticed the pattern? How does this co-product deforms as you reduce this, fraction BPS?
First of all, we have two different co-products that work. One is more in the Drinfeld style, and yes, one is more.
Yeah,
in,
yeah,
the
I'm talking about quasi-half algebras, quasi-triangular, yes, or quasi-half.
One is more Drinfeld style, but another one, of course, they are related. One is more dynamical.
Dynamical, so, that the, involves, you mean dynamical parameter?
No, so it's actually stupid in which sense it's dynamical. So the dynamical
here,
one.
So Elli, here, for example, here you're right. This is the conventional Drinfeld type.
Yes. So the dynamical one, you have to put at least that's what we, you know, between us we call dynamical now, is that here we don't need to have something, we can just put one, and then we have only something here. After the generator.
Yes.
This is like in this language that I'm just telling now, here one and here something.
Yes.
This is beautiful because it really captures all the intuition of the spin chain. So it's visual, basically.
Exactly. That's what I'm trying to say. This is the conventional. You this is the way people deform the quasi-Hopf triangle or non-triangle.
Why do you say that this thing that I call dynamical with one and something, you call it conventional? I would say that there is another
one. No, I'm saying this is, it sounds to me that this is the okay, sorry, I should avoid this. Conventional way to deform co-product. And how does this deforming tensor factors appear? That's all I'm saying. This is what I'm really trying to ask. If you go-
We have to talk another time with more time. Okay. I mean, I don't know. I mean, I could stay here more, but I don't know. Maybe some people-
Okay, maybe want... some other people can ask. But I was just wondering if you-
maybe we should talk slower and maybe with equations.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I don't know. Maybe also you know some magical Russian stuff that I don't know.
But something I can tell you, Samson mentioned on this, sounded to me like dynamical double splitting, like when he was saying that what he calls L operator and some N, it looked to me like a dynamical separation. I can look up. If I find, I can send you reference.
Yes, please.
I heard once a talk of people, one person in Stiklov who is doing this double dynamical separation.
Mm.
I can check.
Okay, sounds great.
Maybe I should keep going.
Pick up on the buttons, that's still the ratio of G, the G's, right?
Sorry, say it again, Anna.
The kappa you had in the batons, that's still the ratio of G1 and G2, right?
Yes, always the ratio, yes.
So it seems related with the tetras in the way you wrote.
Yes, absolutely. There is a very simple, okay, now I am, there is something stupid you do to Q and kappa goes to 1 over kappa. Yes.
Okay, nice.
Yeah, kappa to 1 over kappa is a modular transformation in terms of thetas. Yes, absolutely, yes.
Okay, so I think most of people...
people left
there. But they wrote messages for you in the
yes, chat. I saw it, yes.
So thank you very much, Elli. It was very, very nice. I really enjoyed it.
Yes, thank you.
Thank you, very nice, yes.
It was really great, yes.
Would you like me to send the recording that you said?
Yes, please, I want the recording.
Okay, so when Zoom takes some time to save it after the talk, but then after that, I can send you by
email. I'm not in a hurry, yes. Just send it, yes.
Okay.
Thank you. And we will be in contact. Yes, Anton, also, yes, we will write emails. Yes.
Oh, okay, yeah, I can tell. I will check this. I'm also wondering, have you considered this triangle toric diagrams only, or you have looked at
I have considered more, but the more, you know, big toric diagram you consider, the more you break your... I mean, honestly, I want to have a better language. I want to have a better language before I try to write crazy things.
Yeah, because people...
it looks like it's all about language at this stage.
Yeah, because I know that, okay, this Yamazaki and Galakhov, they are creating BPS algebra for this higher toric diagrams.
Yes.
And I think it's very relevant, but still, there is no generic prescription for the R matrix.
They even, I agree. Yes.
Beyond Nakajima variety, but okay, yes, thanks. I will look up.
Yes.
Just one small thing. What's the reference you recommend to really learn more about this dynamical Young Baxter? Like this Yagi is for the
Yagi, yes.
That's the best one. So if I would like to learn,
I mean, it's not the best. I mean, I cannot say that something is the best. It's very visual.
No. Yeah, it's a good one.
Yeah, I think visual is good.
Okay.
You can also, if you read we have a tiny little bit in our paper where we also cite this guy. But I think we review very quickly, and maybe that's already enough because the visual stuff is already there.
Okay, I just would like to get a bit more intention.
Sorry, Elli, but has Kostas has any proposal for this? Concrete proposal already for this broken algebras or not?
Yeah, we have the algebras.
No. I mean, like, this is part of my question. Like, if you start doing this, n is less than equal 4, how does this quasi-Hopf algebra is deforming low and low, like you say? I understand the argument on the quantum symmetry, but
I cannot tell you because I have to. How's
this? I understand. Okay.
Yeah, I cannot tell you this is how it works magically, but I have calculations that I can show you. Yes.
I can see for the paper when you publish. Okay, because Kostas was given a few days ago a talk, but he was not. Explicit on the deformation of the algebras. I mean, I'm interested in the how it works. That what is this co-commutative for co-product Drinfield language? What is exactly these factors? How they are worked out, or if they are worked out at all, or what is there a pattern?
We have them completely worked out, and in fact, we have them also in a few different conventions and ways, uh-huh. And we also have them for a few different looking twists. And what we have is how you go from the one twist to the other. So, in some sense, this is also why we don't just write a beautiful formula for now, because we try to make it, if you wish, more and more universal.
I see.
If what I say makes sense.
Yes, I understand.
Yes. So right now, the form that we are writing, we have one form that is universal, but some other ones that are total crap. And we try to make also the other ones more universal. So we very recently understood, for example, that the coproduct is one way to do it is one to the left and to the right, kappa, to the eigenvalue of the Z2 operator.
Okay.
That's insane. That's very simple. And like, I mean, it is a good question. Is this completely, totally true? And what is the basis, like concretely, in which this is good? Because all of these questions are also basis dependent.
Exactly.
Yes, absolutely.
Exactly.
So you see, yes. So at this stage, we have 1 billion calculations and we are trying to clean them and understand them, basically.
I see. Yeah.
And this beautiful coproduct with the one to the left and orbifold to the right, this one is the one that generalizes to any number of particles immediately. So this is very beautiful.
Yeah, and another point why I'm saying this from completely different perspective, the way that this coproduct deformation pattern is evolving with the say reduction of the number of the supersymmetry is a characteristic of the integrability in integrable structure. So it's not sometimes it's not just the whole Hopf algebra, but exactly how this coproduct is deformed. Okay, I see. Anyway, thanks.
I have a silly question now. You said the coproduct generalized for any number of particles, the one with the one.
Yes.
In which in the sense of having coproducts in many sides, because usually
yes, in many
to do
sides.
That, you need to associativity. Usually,
yes, I know. So I know.
So how you choose what's good?
One thing to say. Okay, so what I will say now is very mathematical. Okay. It's just natural to write this down. Okay, it's just simply natural. It wants to be written like this. And on the top of that, not only is natural, with all the BPS states calculations, we can test all of that and it works nicely.
Okay.
And the other thing that I now want to do, but that's harder, that's a lot of work, but I will do it because it's awesome. So you can start now taking the non-BPS guys and I want to construct mm-hmm. the multiplets. I know how the multiplets should look like when I am at the orbifold point. I want to construct with the sigma plus and the sigma minus, you know, tack.
Yes.
And then see, test the coproduct like this. And I think what Samson was insisting with the 6J symbol is crucial now. Because so if we can somehow stop thinking about stupid co-product, but knowing that we are basically write down some, you know, Glebs-Gordan coefficient,
yeah,
we finish. Yes.
It makes sense.
Yeah, the Glebs-Gordan structure would be highly restrictive. That's true.
Yes, yes.
Okay.
Okay, thanks again. It was very nice.
Thank you. Have a nice evening.
You too.
And we will be in contact.
Okay.
Bye.
Ciao, bye-bye.
Ciao.